name is Mohita Singh. I'm a cardiology fellow at UT Southwestern in Dallas, Texas, and part of the circulation COVID team. Today, I'm joined by Dr. In-Cheol Kim, a heart failure specialist at the Keimyung University Hospital in Daegu, South Korea. Daegu is the fourth largest city in South Korea, but unfortunately currently home to more than 75% cases of coronavirus in South Korea. Dr. Kim, sorry about the hardships your city is facing, and thank you for your time today.
I'm In-Cheol Kim from Keimyung University Dongsan Hospital, located in Daegu, South Korea. Daegu has become one of the famous cities related with COVID-19 following Wuhan. And we have experienced outbreak at the beginning of the pandemic, and we have settled some of the strategies regarding COVID-19. So in this interview, I would like to share some of the perspectives related to COVID-19.
What kind of cardiovascular complications are you seeing in patients with COVID-19?
I have recently experienced a 21-year-old female with COVID-19-related myocarditis without previous medical history. She was confirmed with COVID-19 and showed typical nature pneumonia with cardiomegaly on chest x-ray. Echocardiography showed ejection fraction of 25% of enlarged left ventricle with also thickened LV myocardium. Cardiac MRI showed diffuse myocardial edema by T2 spare image and myocardial injury by LGE image. According to the previous report, cardiac injury related with COVID-19 ranged 7 to 23%. So it is considered that the pathophysiology of COVID-19 related acute cardiac injury is first ACE2 mediated direct damage and hypoxia induced myocardial injury and cardiac microvascular damage. And lastly, systemic inflammatory response syndrome like cytokine storm. So exact prevalence of cardiac injury is difficult to estimate because of different patient characteristics and different definition of cardiac injury. Limitation of evaluation in COVID-19 for the concern of disease transmission during the test is another factor.
So along those lines, have you seen a high proportion of COVID patients with ACS or cardiac arrhythmias?
Actually, the patient has some kind of arrhythmia, but it was not a fatal arrhythmia. I haven't experienced acute coronary syndrome or fatal arrhythmia yet.
Are you seeing arrhythmias early in the course, later in the course?
In the patient I have mentioned, had a frequent PVCs, but it finally got stabilized during the course.
Given the high prevalence of COVID-19 patients in your city, have you changed protocols regarding your echo lab, cath lab?
Before answering the exact question on that, I have to comment on our whole hospital strategies. So in Daegu, we use concept of safe hospital. At the very beginning of the outbreak, we designated COVID-19 specialized hospitals consisting of public hospital and private hospitals and military hospital to provide specific treatment for COVID-19 patients. So other facilities to isolate infected patients with asymptomatic or having mild symptoms were also operated. But other hospitals are functioning as usual, and we consider them as a safe zone. To do this, triage system is very important. Triage before the entrance, we operate triage when the patient coming to hospitals. So inside the hospital, almost every function is maintained normally with dental masks and keeping general hand sanitizing principles. I have an experience of endomyocardial biopsy in a patient with COVID-19, and I wore powered air purifying respirator to prevent fogging up on my goggles during the procedure. The procedure was done at the CT room right after the computed tomography scan under the guidance of echocardiography for the purpose of not to contaminate multiple rooms.
So there's COVID-19 hospitals and non-COVID-19. Are you at a COVID-19 hospital or?
One of our hospital branch is functioning as a COVID-19 designated hospital. And when the patient is serious, they transfer the patient to us. And we have 20 isolated beds. So we care serious patients in the isolated beds. So exactly, our hospital, whole hospital is safe zone, but we still operate negative pressure isolated rooms to care serious COVID-19 patients.
Then when people are going in to do echoes on these patients, what kind of PPE are they wearing? Or?
We just wear regular dental masks and hand sanitizing, that's all, because presumably the patient, after the triage, the patient is considered as COVID negative.
So is every patient getting screened when they come to the hospital?
Every patient measure their body temperature, but when they have symptoms or when they have a fever, we test COVID-19 before the patient enters the hospital.
So have you guys seen any positive COVID cases in practitioners or clinicians at your healthcare system?
There are, but very rare, because in hospital, after the triage system, the COVID-19 positive patients are supposed not to enter our hospital, but sometimes they get diseases from the society outside of the hospital. So in that case, they can get the disease. And additionally, when the patient turned out COVID-19 positive after the triage system inside the hospital, we test all the related medical personnel and confirm that they have negative test result. They come back to the work.
So to your knowledge, no in-hospital or healthcare-related transmissions at your facility?
In our first facility, there was close contact, several close contact events, but it was very rare.
So people who are not taking care of COVID-19 patients, they're just doing hand sanitizers and masks, and the COVID-19 are in negative pressure rooms. And what kind of PPE for those rooms, again?
Aerosol-generating procedures or close contact procedures to the suspects of COVID-19 infection, when the patient has a fever or when they have symptoms of upper respiratory tract infection, we use regular gowns and protection gowns and gloves and masks and goggles. But when the patient is assumed to be COVID negative, we just wear masks and hand sanitizing, that's all.
Okay, wow. Thank you so much. So just before we end the interview, do you have any final do's and don'ts you would share with the rest of the clinicians out there?
Yes, thank you for the question. I would like to emphasize on the safety. I think number one priority is safety. Safety of non-infected patients and healthcare providers is very important to maintain good quality of medical support. So wearing well-qualified personal protective equipment is especially important for the first-line healthcare providers. So I would like to say, please wear adequate personal protective equipment and follow basic instructions for infection control, which directives of the infectious disease recommend.
Thank you, Dr. Kim. And do you have any specific advice for the first-line providers?
Yes, I would like to recommend not to panic when you care patients with COVID-19. Even when the patient is very urgent, multidimensional strategy for the diagnostic and therapeutic treatments are crucial both for infected patients and non-infected others. I hear very sad news about the first-line workers get infected worldwide. If you care more, the infection transmission from the patients will be minimized during the treatment. And don't let your first-line healthcare providers get exhausted. When our defense line is collapsed, all the society will fall in danger. Send them as much support as you can. At the same time, everyone should do their best at their own position. That's my recommendation.
What specific measures have you taken for your first-line providers in Daegu or in your facility?
Yeah, for instance, we need a lot of resources, like medical doctors and nurses and other healthcare providers. We need a lot of resources. So in Korea, people from the outside of Daegu came to Daegu for volunteer work. They do their work without just minimum pay. They just quit their job and came to Daegu to survive whole city, and that means we can safely protect whole nation from COVID-19, suppressing COVID-19 transmission to other cities. So they focus on managing COVID-19 patients in Daegu voluntarily. I think that's one of the important, there's devotion to protect our nation.
Thank you, Dr. Kim. Thank you very much for your time today and for making a difference in the care of our patients.